Just go with it.
That's it. Shalom, Chavrim. I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live. We have special guest, Brother Paul Begley, on with us from PaulBegleyProphecy.com. Paul Begley YouTube channel as well. Brother Paul, so good to have you with us here today. And I wanted to have Brother Paul on because when he was here in Orlando, right before he left, he brought up a story that he was sharing with me about augmented reality. And it really struck my heart. I was thinking, of course, when Brother Paul was talking to me about this, I was going back to the Atlanta conference where Yana talks about transhumanism and how transhumanism she believed to be a biblical prophecy from Matthew 24, where Jesus is quoting, is saying, I think that's verse 22. Let me just pull that up real quick. I think that's where that's at. Let's see. And except those days should be shortened, there should be no flesh saved, but for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. Now, we realize that there's multiple ways that the scripture and prophecy can be fulfilled, but what Yana was looking at on that, Brother Paul, was that if there's no flesh would be saved, could that be because there would be transhumanist people on the earth and we would be running out of real human being souls? And then you bring up this whole idea of augmented reality. And if, and I only say this as a conjecture, Brother Paul, because if this is something that is biblical, as far as what Yana was talking about in the transhumanism, if you go to the next verse, verse 23, and get the computer to work here, it made me think of what you spoke about, this augmented reality. And that's what I want to really talk to you about again, because it really blew me away. But it says, then if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not. For there shall arise false Christs, false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders. And Brother Paul, I'd like for you to share with the listeners what you had heard about the augmented reality. And keeping in mind as you're listening to this, think about if what Brother Paul is going to tell you, what does the government have beyond that of what we will have access to in the very near future? And that's why I look at the scripture here in Matthew 24. They say, lo, here is Christ, or lo, there is Christ. Are they bringing him into an augmented reality to fool the people? Brother Paul, share with us about this. Amazing. Amazing what you told me.
Yes, thank you so much. Glad to be on with you, Brother Stephen. Let me just say that you're exactly right. This verse is perfect for the augmented reality, that if any man shall say to you, lo, Christ is here or there, believe it not. Now, everybody understands what virtual reality is, and the gaming industry has used it extensively. But that means you're watching, or they can take you into a virtual world. But augmented reality is different. It's taking something from a virtual world and putting it in a real world. It is like Google glasses on steroids. Wow. Basically, and they're already doing it, and it's going to be coming forward very soon. We know that they used to do, and they still use flight simulators, you know, whether you're going to be an astronaut, you're going to learn how to fly a plane, they can put you in a simulation, and you can really feel as if you're flying a plane. But this is actually, you'd be looking at something, you put on these glasses, you're looking, let's say, at a machine that needs a part, and you don't know what that part is. You'll be able to, someone will be able to send you the part, and you can put it in where it goes. Or, Stephen, you and I could be, somewhere in another state, let's say Indiana, like where I'm at, and I could be doing a show, and I would literally just have you set in a chair next to me. It will look to the viewers as if we're both live in the same location. But to take it a step further, it's even more than that. It's bringing in an augmented virtual reality making it, you won't be able to tell you're looking at something with, you're in real world, you know you're in a location, let's say you're outside, but you see two people standing there, you don't know which one's real and which one is augmented. This is where it's going, and this will mess with the mind. You talk about strong delusion.
Yes.
In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, in the age of the Antichrist, they will, of course, be a strong delusion. There will be great deception, lying signs and wonders with all deceivableness. So this scripture that you just quoted, Matthew 24:23, what a way to fool people, to say, look at this. And I mean, folks will actually think for sure they're looking at Jesus Christ in the desert, or Jesus Christ is over here or over there, when it's an augmented reality being inserted into real reality.
That is dangerous, Brother Paul. And the thing is how many people could be duped into this, or what image will they use? I think about, too, where they have, say, for example, the Shroud of Turin, and they have been able to take and compositely from the imprint that was left on this shroud, they were able to make an image to show that this is what they, you know, if this was indeed, I have no idea personally, but if this was indeed the shroud that was on Christ's face, they make this image to look like that. Now, here's the point. You know, I may think, okay, I don't think that it's the authentic shroud, but this really makes no difference in that case, Brother Paul. If you've got millions of people that already believe that there's a good chance that is, and then they can take the image that they've created from that, make a body, use augmented reality, put it out there and say, Christ was in New York last week. It is a major revival. He's returned from the dead. They could use the augmented reality, and the next thing you know, people are flocking, especially, what if they put it with the Pope? You know, because they're not going to allow you to jump up on the Pope mobile anyway. What would happen if you have something like that?
Or you could say the resurrection of the Prophet Muhammad, or Muhammad has returned, or the Mahdi, the Muslim Messiah, the 12th Imam.
Yes.
And multiple hundreds of thousands of people could see it with their own visual eyes, eyewitnesses, like you said, in the Pope mobile, riding along with the Pope, and it could be Jesus Christ blessing or endorsing the Pope in the Pope mobile as he rides through St. Peter's Square. No one knew this was coming. No one knew this was going to happen. They could create this unbelievable miracle, but it's nothing more than lying signs and wonders.
Yes.
Great. And Stephen, the augmented reality is a live, direct, or indirect view of a physical, real-world environment whose elements are augmented by a computer-generated perceptible information. It's literally changing in multiple sensory modulating. All right, so it will train the brain. It will literally deceive the brain into believing what they saw. You know, I think about Fatima, you know, and
right. And how, yes, exactly.
70,000 people thought they saw something that day because they were told something was going to appear that day. I don't know, but think about something like that happening, and Virgin Mary arising somewhere. There's all kinds of things that can be done to fool the people.
Well, you know, you bring that out, Pastor Paul Begley, and the thing that's interesting to me is I remember my stepdad worked for the military, and he never said, I always wondered if he didn't work at Area 51. There was an incident that happened with a general in him that really went down kind of interesting. He ended up having to leave the military after this particular incident, and he used to say to me, and I've never actually spoke about this publicly before, but I remember years ago, we had came out with a new stealth type of plane at the time, and I was just amazed by it. And he told me, he says, you have no idea, son. He said, that is nothing. He said, we had that 20 years ago. And I'm like, stop for a moment. I asked him, I said, what do you mean 20 years ago? He said, you never see in the public eye what we really have until about 20 years later. He said, that's when we allow that to go public. And then we think about, and of course we know technology is going much faster, so perhaps maybe not 20 years in a case like this with augmented reality, but let's say maybe 10 years or 5 years ago, they already had this. Maybe when the Fatima, this miracle was happening, or supposed miracle, maybe they were already using augmented reality. I know personally, Pastor Paul, I know personally a couple of the men that are involved in testing the technology of Apple's iPhones. And, you know, we have iPhone 8 right now. Well, these guys are already using iPhone 10. They're always 2 years ahead of whatever you have. Because back when we had the iPhone 4, they had the iPhone 6. And, you know, people would ask him, you know, what do you got there? He said, what's iPhone 6? What do you mean iPhone 6? We do the prototype testing. So what you're talking about, that's what I'm looking at.
I was talking, Heidi was getting a new phone because her plan was up, and she actually got the Google 8, I think is what she got, was the Google 8. And I have a Samsung 7. And my wife, Heidi, looked right at the guy and said, what's the next greatest innovation and information coming? He said, augmented reality. It will be on your phone. It will blow your mind. It is Google Glasses on steroids. And so apparently, as you're saying, there's guys already out there testing this thing. Remember when the Google Glasses came out? You know, you'd be able to be walking, you could see, but then you could also pop on the screen of your glasses, you know, something you were Googling. Well, this is going way past that. This is actually projecting the image in front of you as if it is there. You will not know the difference between two things. It's mixed reality. That's another word they use, or computer mediated reality. But it will definitely affect your visual, audio areas of the brain, memory. I mean, this is going to augment the brain's perception of everything. And think about it. Your brain, Stephen, will be trying to figure out, is this real, or is this reality, or is this virtue? And this analyzation is going to be going on, and people's perception of what they thought they saw or what they think they're seeing is going to be altered beyond your comprehension. And I believe the eyes are the window to the soul. And yes. So this is a way to get into the soulical part of man. There's going to be a literally a dangerous invasion, if you will, into the soulical heart of man.
Wow. That is just wild, Brother Paul. Very wild. All right, let's move on. I'd like to cover a couple of topics with you, Brother Paul, while we have you on. And of course, we know we stirred up a whirlwind here on Israeli News Live when we brought out about the Prime Minister resigning on Monday. And this, of course, though there's a lot of people that don't believe it, and as we stated on Israeli News Live, we didn't want to see that happen, especially in light of the situation that was going on in Israel right now. There's a lot of tensions that we have. Right now we're dealing with Gaza. In fact, you may not be aware of this as of yet, Brother Paul, but there was a video that just surfaced on Mamre TV, where Mamre Television, which is an Arabic news station there, was showing a manufacturing facility over in Gaza where they're making 120 caliber or 120 millimeter missiles that they're building right there in Gaza to launch into Israel. And they are building hundreds of them. They literally show the entire assembly that they're doing there. Very careful on how they bring this out so that people don't really know where that facility is located at. But and also it puts the residents that live in Gaza at danger too, because when Israel has to respond to knock out the targets, you know, there is going to be collateral damage, just no way around it. And you would think that the people in Gaza would have enough sense to wake up and say, look, quit shelling Israel. But not only that, Brother Paul, we've got the dispute now with Hezbollah over Area 9 and the drilling process off the coast of Israel and Lebanon, and Hezbollah saying that they're going to defend their rights for drilling exploration there. We have Russia talking about putting in a military base or at least making an agreement with Lebanon to be able to port their military ships there, also using their air runways. We have Syria. We'll go to Syria separately, but we have the danger of Iran and their proxies inside of Syria with Israel. And we just had some Suman Tov here on Israeli News Live this morning, or was it yesterday morning? I forget which day. I think it was yesterday, actually. And Suman Tov brought out a very important thing, and I want to just share that with you real quick, Pastor Paul, before I get your thoughts on these issues here. We were discussing Prime Minister Netanyahu and the thoughts of the Israeli people. Now, Suman Tov, he said that the Orthodox community is not behind Prime Minister Netanyahu like they were. He said they really began to distrust him and his leadership. But as Suman brings out too, he says it doesn't mean, though, that Netanyahu is not the man for the job. And I thought it was interesting, and he clarified his standing on this. He said the Israeli people are more and more turning away. He said if Netanyahu were to go for another election, he would not win. He said, I really believe that he would not win. He said, but, he says, what is it? He says, when I say he's the man for the job, he said, it's not that he will do something good, but the thing that he is going to do is what will usher in the coming of the Mashiach, the Messiah. He said, in other words, what I'm saying, brother, is that he's going to create a situation for Israel where the enemies of Israel are going to attack Israel. He said, it's not the right thing he's doing, but yet in the sense of a biblical prophecy, he said, the only way you will ever get the Orthodox community or the Israeli people to go to their knees and truly seek for the coming of the Messiah is when we see the scripture being fulfilled where 2/3 of the nation are killed as a result of the attack of the enemy. And he says, I do believe that he is the man for the job. He said he will cause those nations to come against us before God is finished with him. And that just blew me away. I've said for years, too, Brother Paul, that this whole thing about a two-state solution, that the only way they'll ever make it happen is when Israel, using Israel to push a war with its neighbors that will bring a war against them, that will force the Jewish people out of the areas that they don't want them in, that would allow them to carve up the land, and this all would happen. All right, Brother Paul, let's get your insights on these things.
Great, great information from Suman Tov. Well, you know, in Matthew 24, where you were at, just before you get to will there be any flesh saved, there is a period of time right after the abomination of desolation when it says that let them which are in Judea to flee into the mountains. Okay, let them which are on the housetop not come down to take anything, neither let them which are in the field return back and take his clothes. And woe unto them that were child, them that give suck in those days. Pray that your flight be not in the winter. Okay, we know that this is the Jews that are in Judea and Samaria happen to flee. That's the West Bank. Yes. Which, oh, by the way, Rabbi Yehuda Glick is their representative in the Knesset.
Yes, he is.
Which is quite ironic. But there's going to be a time like never before. Great sorrow, great woe. I mean, we could call it Jacob's troubles. If we went to Jeremiah chapter 3, I think it is. But one thing's for sure, something's happening. The surrounding of all the nations. But Brother Stephen, just a few days ago, there's been a phenomenal discovery. This may be the hook for the jaw that it talks about in Ezekiel 38. Zion Oil and Gas just discovered, an American company, yes, owned by John Brown, just discovered the absolute largest amount of oil and gas in all of the Middle East. And guess where it's at? Megiddo. It's in Megiddo.
Yes.
I mean, that's Armageddon. That's the battlefield. So Zion Oil and Gas, a Christian company that believes in the blessing of Israel. And the reason John Brown did this is he had a vision from the Lord. He lives in Michigan. He had a vision from the Lord to help Israel become self-sufficient and economically independent. And the Lord told him to go and find the oil. Now, this was back in 1988. He has been searching. Of course, they had found oil and they found gas, and he does in different places of the world, but primarily was focused on Israel. And he has just announced this discovery. It's so large, it's so mammoth, that his stock went up 87% on the big board in the NASDAQ. Anyone who owns stock, it went out, it went through the roof because of the enormity of this gas and oil. And this may be the hook. that brings these enemies, this brings this attack, Brother Stephen, to try to destroy Israel. And then that may, and look, Benjamin Netanyahu's the prime minister. Who knows what else goes on? He's shaking. Remember, he's standing in Munich, Germany yesterday with a piece of the Iranian drone, shaking it in their face, and says, you don't want to test the resolve of Israel. And Iran is firing back. You don't want to deal with the response if you do this. I mean, it's getting dangerous, but it is biblical prophecy. It's the cup of trembling. It's Zechariah 12. It is coming to pass before our very eyes. And this might be what causes the parting of the land. There's a prophecy that you have talked about, and I've talked about, especially when John F. Kerry, the second, former Secretary of State, when he was trying to put together that 9-month peace agreement, where it says that in Rebecca's womb was twins.
That's right.
Two nations and two manner of people. And every time I think, well, maybe they're not going to do a two-state solution, Yehuda Glick slammed his desk and said, no, it's not going to happen. I can't help but go to the Bible. There's two nations. They are going to be formed. And whether we like it or not, even though God said, don't part my land, it's apparent that there will be a parting of the land. There will be a dividing. It looks as if that's where we're going.
Well, you hit it, I think, on the nail on the head in this case here, Pastor Begley, when you brought out this Megiddo oil discovery. And of course, it came out in the news today as well that Israel has just signed the largest ever natural gas and oil agreement with Egypt. Now that was something that we were discussing with Simon Tov yesterday, and of course they hadn't come out with the deal on that yet. But Simon Tov said what's interesting. He said they're pushing for a one state. He says because why? He said Israel is working with the regional powers, including Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Jordan. And he said right now he says we have bombers. Israeli bombers sitting on Saudi runways. He said, ready to go after Iran. And, of course, we already knew that Israel, and I haven't really covered it that extensively yet, that Israel is working with the Egyptian government and has been bombing ISIS militants inside of the Sinai Peninsula. So, and then you bring this out about the Megiddo discovery.
Yes.
You know, that makes more sense than why Russia is sending their envoys to Lebanon, because if there is oil in Megiddo, if you get up there to southern Lebanon there and you begin to drill there, you may tap into that same reserve. It may spread under like a spider underground. And I think this is why Russia, because, you know, the thing is, at the end of the day, Pastor Paul, all these nations, whether it be the U.S., whether it be Russia, whether it be Iran, whether it be France, Germany, they're all after one thing, and that's for the last remaining oil deposits and reserves on the earth. And they all are right around Israel, Lebanon, and all these places here. It's going to be a knockdown, drag-out fight, and it's coming. I'm afraid it's coming sooner than what we really want to see.
And Stephen, Brother Stephen, if you look here, you got... Yeah, Saudi Arabia's got a lot of oil, right? Russia's got a lot of oil. Iran's got a lot of oil, but they're pumping it out like mad. And this is the largest oil reserves in the world, sitting in the Valley of Megiddo, where the biblical battle of Armageddon is going to happen. And we've got birds that are migrating to Megiddo now. It's the largest migration of vultures in the history of the world. They come every year. Why? The Bible says that they're going to be summoned where the carcasses are, where the eagles be gathered together. It tells you there's going to be a battle in Armageddon that's going to be so bad it will take 7 months to bury the dead and 7 years to get rid of the weaponry, which is no doubt some type of radiation weaponry. And it'd be incredible battle. And it says in Ezekiel 38, it tells you the Fab Five nations and others that will be involved in this invasion of Israel in Megiddo. And there's no reason. I've been there. You've been there. I've been there several times. You've been there. And every time I'm there, I stand on Mount Carmel or I stand over on Mount Megiddo and I look at the Valley of Armageddon, I call it, and I look at it and I say, why? Why would you come here and fight? I don't get it. Now I get it. The largest deposit of oil in the world. Look what's going up right now in northern Syria and where the Kurds are. Look what's going on. Rex Tillerson striking deals to back off Turkey. Syria's sneaking in there saying, hey, Kurds, we'll help you. Why? It's about the oil that's up there. It's unreal. But think about it. When they tap this oil well and gas, it's going to come out of Megiddo. It's going to be so enormous. Everybody's going to want to get their hands on it. And it's unbelievable. I think we're so close. These biblical prophecies are coming together so fast, we can't keep up with them.
You know, this may be, Pastor Paul, exactly why the different nations have positioned themselves all in the Middle East to begin with. Russia, United States, Turkey, Saudi, well, the Saudis don't have their troops there, but we have other troops. We have from France and Norway. You'd be surprised some of the troops that are there. Germany is in the country of Jordan. They moved all from the Encirclement Air Base down to the country of Jordan here on the southern side of Syria. And with that, as you mentioned, the latest move of the Syrian government making an agreement with the Kurds right now, the State Department, Rex Tillerson, backing away from the Kurds and strengthening their relationship with Turkey. It looks like that Syria is going to be the counter peg that blows up. But could it be, Pastor Bagley, that this is going to be the excuse they use to be able to let that war spread into Israel?
It could be.
Could it be that it just begins to, they allow, in other words, even with Russia, because Russia's about getting that oil too.
Right.
All right? There ain't none of them good when it comes to that. U.S. is no different. We got over there, we got embedded with the Kurds, and we have tried to secure all the oil rigs there on the eastern side of the Euphrates. That's the largest reservoir that Syria does have. We've secured it over there. Russia is angry. They sent in, now the estimates, you know, we broke that story on February 8th before any of the mainstream, not even Russian, Iranian, none of them had broke the story about the hundred that was killed, Assyrian soldiers with Russian mercenaries. Well, finally the facts came out. There were dozens of Russian mercenaries from the Wagner Corporation that were killed in that battle. Not just 10, as we originally reported, 10, dozens were killed, and an estimated of up to 300 altogether were killed in that battle. And they say that Russia was trying to see if they could take that oil reserve that was being held by ISIS over there, and also to take out the Syrian base, which we had American soldiers there working with the Free Syrian Army over there. And that's what caused the U.S. to respond the way they did. All right, now, some people say, oh, I can't believe Russia's over there doing that. Okay, Russia's no better than the U.S. We have Blackwater, and we do stuff. And you know, the Russians learn from the Americans, and they're both using their proxy fighters, their contracted soldiers to fight in different battles so that they're not considered head-on in a confrontation to avoid nuclear war. I've seen Ukraine. I've seen Russian mercenaries being used from the Wagner group in Ukraine to battle against the Ukrainian government for Donetsk and Luhansk. I've seen the actual video footage of American soldiers wearing Ukrainian uniforms, couldn't speak a lick of Russian or Ukrainian language, only could speak in English, good old American Southern English, being filmed. They're part of Blackwater. You know, and they were fighting against Donetsk. So it happens all over the world. But it's all, Brother Paul, it's about that oil. And as you're bringing out here with this huge discovery that's just been made there in Megiddo, like you said, there's the hook. It's not that they want, that's why we see the hook. They don't want to go against Israel. But then at the end of the day, they're all going to battle it out. And I think that even the United States will battle it out as well. And it may cause collateral damage and kill Israelis as well. But it's not going to matter at that point. Everybody wants to get their hands on that. And what if Obama ends up back in the White House? Or what, you know, heaven forbid, what if something happens to Trump? You already know, Pastor Paul. I mean, we saw it. You saw it for yourself when Roger Stone says they got three different plans. They've already tried one, that didn't work. They're on phase two, and if phase two doesn't work, he said they got phase three. And this is a man that loves President Trump, but he knows what the deep state is out to do. They want him out of the office and to try to take over. And that's not good.
That's absolutely true, Brother Stephen. There's no question that the deep state has feverishly worked to remove President Donald Trump from the White House. The Russian collusion confusion story is not selling with the American people. Obviously, Trump did not go into collusion with Russia to try to make sure he won the election. And these 13 Russians, which is a nice Illuminati number, these 13 Russians that are being charged for doing what? A few ads on Facebook? You know what their total amount of money these guys spent? As a matter of fact, two of the guys on the list, they don't even know why they're on the list. Even the sources that work for Mueller are saying, wait a minute, who, Victor who? That was two of those guys weren't even in the details. They spent $40,000 total on Facebook. The Democratic National Committee spent $81 million just with Facebook. So $40,000 worth of ads by 13 Russians did not convince the American public who to vote for in the election. It's a joke. It's a farce. It's a fake dossier. And that's how they got the FISA. They got the FISA warrant to chase down poor little Carter Page and to say he might be a potential agent, Russian spy, and then they could go after the next three levels of people who might have been connected. This was orchestrated by Barack Hussein Obama, and it was to put Hillary Clinton in power one way or another. If she couldn't win the election, then they have to impeach the president. If they can't impeach him, then they have to use Article 25 and say he's mentally deranged. If it isn't Article 25, then it's assassination, potentially, could be the plan. So we got to pray and cover the president, his family, the vice president, his family. The Christians are being persecuted. Vice President Mike Pence is being called mentally ill for talking to Jesus. I mean, it's getting crazy what's going on out there.
Jeez. And now the attack on the Second Amendment, you know, the right to bear arms.